more interested in what is this global imbalance, the term that I think many of us have heard. Arguably, I think this is the most hottest topic among not only economists, but also political scientists. And I think a lot of scholars are actually somewhat running away from this topic. Is China manipulating the currency exchange rate, because it is so controversial? And often at times when I discuss with my colleagues or professors, some of them do not tend to not like to talk about this too much because it is so controversial. But I think tonight my job is not to really get into detail of my belief about this issue, but rather just talk about the general information about what is global imbalance, how does China play a role in it, and its peg, and also its intervention in the market, such as the US Treasury market, the US agency security market, how these things are actually contributing to the creation and the maintenance of this global imbalance, I think, which has a huge consequence if we don't do anything about it in the near future. That being said, this is the first time I'm going to present my case at ARI, and I hope to come back from time to time. So I think a little bit of introduction about how I got into the interested in the China and its exchange rate or economics is probably in order. 2 years ago, I went to China and visited several cities, and I'd like to share a story that took place in this city called Zhengzhou, which I'm probably not pronouncing it right, so don't try to locate in your head. I went there because it was the closest city to Shaolin Temple. At the time, I was not interested in economics of China whatsoever. I was just interested in Bruce Lee. So I visited this city, and my credit card failed to function, which now that I consider myself an amateur economist, I'm ashamed to say. But anyway, my credit card failed to function, so my budget really shrunk in a moment. So I made a couple friends in the town, and I asked them where I can get some cheap food. Turns out that right behind this business hotel that I was staying at, there was this noodle store that he took me to. In this noodle store, I still remember it was this bowl of noodle, which is huge, with vegetables and meat and everything, and it cost 4 RMB. RMB is the currency unit of China, which I'll refer to throughout tonight's discussion, also known as Chinese yuan. So if I say RMB, it's Chinese yuan. 4 RMB is equivalent to 50 cents in the United States, because 8 RMB or 8 Chinese yuan is $1. 50 cents noodle, and I was be able to be full. Every day I was really thankful. Right around this restaurant, there were a lot of people starving or pushing carts full of rotten bananas and whatnot, which I'll never pay a penny to eat. Then I walked back to my business hotel, and I see a lot of foreigners, businessmen, staying there for a few nights or whatnot. And every night I saw a lot of foreigners, businessmen, come out from the basement, obviously drunk and had a lot of fun with Chinese girls on their side. And I asked them, and it turns out there's a club or disco or some kind of a music hall downstairs. And just for the entry, it cost 500 RMB, which is approximately about $50. So to them, it's a peanut. To the people on the street who can't even eat a noodle or 4 RMB, it's a lot of money that they'll never earn in their life, maybe. So this kind of income inequality after 2 decades of economic growth that China has achieved is really interesting, because you look at India, their Gini index, which is a measure of income inequality, is upper 20s or lower 30s, while China has a Gini index of upper 40s or low 50s, which is one of the highest in the world. Top 20s probably, and if they continue the economic growth, it's going to be even more severe. So in other words, China's economic growth has come with a cost, a huge income inequality that not all the developing economies really have to go through. And global imbalance, in my argument, and in the end I'll make, actually is relevant to this income inequality in China, I believe. That being said, I'd like to start my slideshow. So global imbalance in China, as China manipulates currency exchange rate. That's over here. Okay, battery's on. Okay. I think the first question I think we should first of all discuss is, what is this global imbalance? We've heard enough in the magazines, and if you did not, I believe you will hear it sooner or later. The term, it takes two to tango, really makes sense to me. Some economists really try to distinguish two players who create this global imbalance. Some would say China has nothing to do with it. Nobody really says the U.S. has nothing to do with it, but there are economists out there, Joseph Stiglitz, Robert McKinnon, some Stanford University, who say that China is not really responsible. But to me, I believe it certainly is. What is this imbalance you're talking about? This imbalance, first of all, I think you should not think of this imbalance between the rich and the poor. That is nothing new. We always had it. And if anything, China is having 10% GDP growth and the U.S. 3-4%. So their GDP is actually getting smaller. So it's not the imbalance between the rich and the poor. This imbalance is actually between the debtor, which is the U.S., and the creditor, which is the rest of the world. And this may sound funny to all of us because arguably the U.S. is the richest country in the world with a GDP of 13 trillion, second being Japan with less than 6 trillion. So the richest country in the world is the debtor, and the rest of the world is the creditor who is financing these deficits that the U.S. is making every single year. In the economic terms, we call this imbalance between the current account deficit the U.S. holds and the current account surplus the rest of the world holds. This current account, I think I should explain in a very simple analogy. Basically, let us suppose that the U.S. makes $100. Let us suppose that China makes $100. Let us suppose that these two countries are the only countries that exist and there's no other money in the world. Theoretically speaking, if it would be great if the U.S. spends $100 and China spends $100. That would be wonderful. But in reality, the U.S. actually tends to spend $150 while it makes $100. In this case, the U.S. would have current account deficit of $50. Now, to spend $150 while you make only $100, you have to borrow $50. In this world, theoretically speaking, there's only country China, so China actually finances, in other words, sends $50 to the U.S. So China is saving $50 while you make $100. So China has current account surplus of $50. And then there's a capital account, which is basically capital going back and forth. China is sending $50 to the U.S. The U.S. is receiving $50. There's a capital account surplus of $50. Whereas in the case of China, it's not receiving $50. It is actually sending. So there's a capital account deficit, in this scenario at least. So that is a global imbalance. And this graph shows, in 1999, this big blue, that's the U.S. You might wonder, you know, this is kind of funny because in 1999, I thought we had a wonderful economic growth. Well, even if we have economic growth, sometimes we have a U.S. current account deficit because current account deficit is not always just consuming, it is also investing, which is nothing wrong. So back then, it was not a big amount, and this is the European Union member, this is Japan, and this is emerging economies. Now you look at 2005 in this one, you can obviously see that the U.S. current account deficit not only tripled but quadrupled from $200 billion to last year, $820 billion. In this, theoretically, as I just explained, if there's a current account deficit somewhere, there must be a current account surplus somewhere else. The European Union members, as you can see, has not really much changed. You look at Japan, yes, it increased, but not a whole lot. And then you look at this green, and you look at this green, obviously emerging economies are the ones who actually came up with the idea of, hey, why don't I just make a current account surplus and send that over to the U.S. for whatever the reason that is. That is the thing called the Bretton Woods II, which is the term that economists such as Dooley, Fockers, and Landau of Deutsche Bank refer to. Basically, before the Bretton Woods ended, the idea was the U.S. dollar and the gold would allow a current country to finance, print its currency or whatever not. After the Bretton Woods I ended in 1970 with a Nixon shock, it became somewhat unofficial. You could print as much currency as you want if you like to have inflation, that is. In Bretton Woods II idea is basically that, okay, why don't we just make the U.S. dollar alone? If you have the U.S. dollar, you could print the currency. This is not official, again, this is just an idea. But according to these economists at Deutsche Bank, this is what the world is doing. They're accumulating the U.S. dollar. With that as a collateral, they print the currency. They send these current account surplus that they earn back to the U.S. And the U.S., what do they do with it? They buy more imports from these countries. So there's obviously a recycle going on. One thing I'd like to note here is that you look at emerging economies, it increased. Fine. Which country? China. From $15.7 billion in 1999 and to $158.6 billion, one country alone. I think, you know, to a certain extent, this alone would tell us that it's hard to say that China has nothing to do with the U.S. current account deficit, if the, you know, this idea is true. Next slide. You might wonder, but what is the big deal about this global imbalance? So what? You know, if there's one country that has huge debts and one other country has huge, a lot of loans given out, what's the big deal? You might wonder. Well, the scenario, this is the worst consequence in a sense. What if this CB stands for central banks? Arguably, these central banks abroad are actually the ones who are buying the U.S. Treasury, sending the current account surplus to the U.S. and actually, you know, executing this Bretton Woods II idea. What if these central banks all of a sudden say, you know what, the U.S. dollar seems to be going down, you have too much debts, your GDP growth is going down with the demographic issues and whatnot, so I'm not going to buy any more of these U.S. treasuries. You may think this is, you know, hard to imagine. Well, Japan already did that in 2004. Since 2004 second half, Japan completely stopped buying the U.S. treasury. So it's possible. And what would happen if these central banks stop buying the U.S. treasury? Whenever these foreigners buy the U.S. treasury, they first have to convert their currencies to the U.S. dollar and then buy the U.S. treasury. So whenever they make this transaction, there's a demand for the U.S. dollar, which allows the U.S. dollar to stay strong. If they stop doing this, then obviously the U.S. dollar would weaken and inflation domestically could occur. And if that occurs, what would the Fed do? The Fed would raise the rate to stop contain the inflation. The Fed went up from 1% in 2004 already to 5% today, and it's ready to rise to 5.25% on June 29th this month. So I think this is also happening already. And if inflation occurs in the U.S., inflation will be transmitted to China because China's currency is arguably still pegged to the U.S. dollar more later. As long as it's pegged to the U.S. dollar, if the U.S. dollar falls, RMB would also fall. That's the idea of a peg. So inflation in China could also occur. And if the U.S. Has a recession after all this interest rate rising, because if the interest rate rises, us consumers will not be able to borrow from the banks as easily as we used to, so the consumption goes down. And the business will not be able to borrow money from the banks as easily as they used to, so the investment and hiring would also go down. If that occurs, recession in the U.S. is very likely, and today most economists agree that the U.S. economy is slowing down already. What would happen if the U.S. has a recession? It is pretty obvious that the recession in the U.S. would be transmitted to the rest of the world. We saw this in 2000-2001 after the dot-com bust, September 11th attack. The U.S. GDP is at least 30% of the global GDP. So, it's almost automatic. If the U.S. falls into recession, it's pretty obvious that the rest of the world would face the same consequence. The worst even scenario, which I'll refer to only a little bit, what if the U.S. defaults on the treasury payment? The U.S. owes a lot of U.S. treasuries abroad, which everybody thinks they're going to pay up. You may think that's impossible, the U.S. treasury, but arguably in 1970, when the Nixon shock, I believe similar situation already occurred. So I think it's hard to say this will never happen. And also, the U.S. dollar may lose its position as a global currency. Something like euro may take over if the U.S. dollar, again, is stopped financed by U.S. Central banks. If that occurs, the world economy, I believe, would fall in a little bit of panic. One of the many reasons why the Great Depression occurred, one of the many, is that the world was somewhat divided between whether to choose Great Britain sterling or the U.S. dollar. And one of the funny similarities is that Great Britain sterling before the World War I also had a current account deficit, huge, just like the U.S. today. The next question you may say, if you know, you may say, but it didn't happen last year. The world economy is beautiful, wonderful. We had 4.7%, 4.9% GDP growth worldwide. So what are you talking about? And my answer to that would be, actually, you're right. This is a graph of the U.S. dollar last year starting from June till December 2005 against the euro and Japanese yen. You can see the positive slope. Obviously, the U.S. dollar appreciated. Global imbalance theorists like myself would say that the U.S. dollar would go down, but it didn't go down. So you may think, you know, what are you talking about? But my answer continues, but that was because the Fed raised its rate, while other central banks did not. And this graph shows you that. This is Bank of Japan, 0% the entire way. You can barely see it because it's zero. They're fighting the deflation, so it's understandable they have 0% interest rate. This is the European Central Bank, all the way 2%. In the last November, they raised 25 basis points. This is the Fed. If you're a global investor with money in your hands, in which bank would you put the money into? Obviously the American bank, with the interest rate rising. So all this money coming into the US obviously allowed the US dollar to appreciate. One of the many reasons why the US dollar appreciated last year, despite its current account deficit. And my argument continues. This year has been a little bit different. This is the graph of the US dollar value against the euro and Japanese yen. Obviously, the slope is downward this time, starting in January and May. Against the euro and Japanese yen, it is collapsing. It is starting to fall, little by little. But nonetheless, obviously, I think it's easy to see why. A European Central Bank is raising the rate. Bank of Japan is also set to start raising its rate. The rest of the world, India, Canada, Korea, you name it, all the central banks in the world are raising the rates. Why? The oil price and the global economic growth that has been so robust that inflation is a concern now. And you may wonder how are the other countries doing now that the US seems set to get into a recession, and the rest of the world also, how are they doing? Because global imbalance theorists like myself would say that it will be transmitted to the rest of the world. My answer is not good. Equity-wise, these are some of the headlines we've seen in the Bloomberg this year. Emerging market stocks fell, set for the biggest drop in 2 years. Indonesia's Jakarta Composite Index slumping 6.3%. The Russian Trading System Index tumbling 5%. Now, in this slide, I'm going to talk about the emerging economies, obviously. When you talk about the emerging economies, from my perspective, there seems to be two kinds of emerging economies. One kind of emerging economy that depends on a foreign direct investment, investment from abroad, and they have a trade surplus. Wonderful. Everybody's happy. That sounds like a great idea if the Fed rate is low, the 1% in 2004 as it was, European Central Bank also low, and Bank of Japan is low. Because if these rates are low, global investors can easily get the money from these big central banks and invest in these emerging economies. So now that these big central banks are raising the rates, foreign direct investment is not coming in. What would happen? These emerging economies that were overly dependent on these foreign direct investment is starting to show signs of decline. What about the currencies? Turkish lira hit its lowest level in nearly a year and a half, and Iceland krona also hit its 23-month low. What happened here? Another type of emerging economy is emerging economies who had crises in the last few years, who have a lot of external debts, and they need to finance their deficits. Turkey and Iceland are both the same in this category. What do? They raise their rates tremendously. Iceland krona, Iceland's central bank is as high as 10 or 11, 12%. When they raise the rate so high, they can easily get the money to finance these deficits because global investors can borrow money easily from the European Central Bank or the Fed, Bank of Japan, because they're all low, and send the money over to these countries who need this money to be financed. But once the Fed raises its rate, now 5%, European Central Bank 2.75 since yesterday, Bank of Japan also set to raise its rate, the money is not coming in. So what would happen? The money is not coming into their banks as deposits. So their currency would collapse. So my argument first is that the global imbalance certainly exists, and it is growing. And if we don't do anything about it, I think we will see more consequences. Last year we did not, but I think this year we'll definitely start to see more signs. Notice that my argument, I said argument, not conclusion. Anything that I say is not definitive. Plenty of economists disagree with me, so you're more than welcome to disagree and dispute with what I'm saying. And how is the U.S. current account, which I just mentioned, is very bad? Obviously, I gave a sign already. Not good. In 2005, not many of us may know, but actually, we saw some effort by the U.S. to reduce this current account deficit. The fiscal deficit by the Bush administration actually went down from $420 billion in 2004 to $320 billion in 2005. There was a little effort. The Fed also raised its rate from 1% in June 2004 to 4.25% by the end of 2005. What would this do? This would stop the Americans from consuming beyond their means, obviously. So there was a little bit of effort. But what happened? But the current account deficit increased. In 2004, it was $668.1 billion, which is 5.7% of GDP. Again, this basically means that if the U.S. makes $13 trillion a year, it is consuming not $13 trillion, but it's consuming $13 trillion and $668.1 billion in a very simple explanation. What happened in 2005? It went up $804.9 billion last year, which is 6.4% GDP. Barry Eichengreen, the professor at University of California, Berkeley, would say that if the GDP, if our economy is growing by 3% or so a year, inflation included, maybe 5%, and if our current account deficit is increasing by 6.4%, then obviously our debts are going to get bigger and bigger, and it's not going to be sustainable. Very easy, simple to understand, and I think it holds, it speaks the truth. And you may wonder why. How did the current account deficit is getting so big? Bureau of Economic Association in the U.S. simply says an increase in the deficit on goods, trade deficit, to $781.6 billion in 2005 from $665.4 billion in 2004, counting most of the increase. In the trade deficit, there is service and goods, both of them. The U.S. actually has a surplus in terms of services. The goods is the one the U.S. is not really good at, and that's the one we have $781.6 billion. So that is the reason why we have current account deficit getting bigger. You may wonder, how does the U.S. finance its deficit? I referred to this already a little bit. It's either sell debts or equity. And this is argued by Dr. Rubini of NYU, Stern Business School. His argument is that you need to basically bring in the money to finance the deficit. Well, how do you bring in the money? One way is sell the debts. You sell the treasury. You sell the treasury, you get the money, and you pay off other debts. But when you do this, you're making another debt. So you're paying off the debt by creating another debt, which is really somewhat incomprehensible. Equity, how do you sell the equity? Well, that's obvious. You sell the stocks or the shares. But in the worst case, you sell the company itself. China bought the part of IBM software division, called it a Lenovo. They tried to buy Unocal, the oil company, last year, and it was politically denied by the U.S. and U.S. And you can understand this, I think you can relate to this easily from the recent incident. Dubai tried to buy a port on the East Coast. They have a lot of profits last year, the oil price rising from $20 in 2003 to now $75. Why not? But the U.S. doesn't like that, obviously. It's understandable. This is the graph from 1930 to 2005. The one below is the current account, in other words, deficit. At this time, throughout this entire time, we didn't have any current account deficit, as you can see. The above is the assets in the U.S. owned by the foreigners. This is a very simple graph to understand, I believe. As long as we don't have a current account deficit, the foreigners don't own our assets. The Americans own our assets, simply put. But once we have a current account deficit get bigger and bigger, obviously, the foreigners will continue to own more assets. So if this continues, as global imbalance continues to enlarge, I believe the slope is going to be like this, and it's going to be like this. The U.S. may be owned by the foreigners. And if this continues, obviously, protectionism by the U.S. administration would start that we've seen already with the Dubai and the Unocal and whatnot, which is nothing healthy to the global economy. Again, I referred to already that we had a current account deficit in 1990. So what's the big deal? Well, now we have a current account deficit. The thing about it is, back in the 1990s, we had a current account deficit financed through investment into, you know, high tech and all those things. Basically, the equity side, which is great, healthy, wonderful. We get the economic growth going on. Today, how is our current account deficit financed? Through the sales of the U.S. treasuries. Last year alone, we sold $720 billion worth of U.S. Treasury. So it's nothing healthy at all. We're paying off the debts by creating more debts. This is not sustainable, at least in my argument. I'd like to go to the next. And I just mentioned with the previous slide, the one before, that the current account deficit of the U.S. is mostly increased due to the trade deficit in the goods. Well, where is the U.S. trade deficit coming from? This is 2005, all the countries that have the current trade situation with the U.S. China had $200 billion trade surplus with the U.S. and the rest of the world. If you look at this graph, it's obvious that China plays a big role in terms of creating the trade deficit on the U.S. And, as I explained, because the trade deficit consists of so much area in the U.S. current account deficit, again, it's hard to say that China has nothing to do with the U.S. current account deficit. Looking at this graph, though, I think a lot of economists and a lot of people in the audience may say, well, you know, this is not really accurate because China is actually more assembling things. For example, Japan and Korea actually send a lot of exports to China. They assemble products, and it's shipped to the U.S. So this trade deficit, trade surplus of China alone does not represent that of the China. Actually, it represents more a lot of East Asian countries. That is actually true. And we can go on forever in that regard. But I think, you know, at least this graph shows a direct relationship wise. Obviously, China's trade surplus plays a big role in creating the US current account deficit. And at this point, China's export industry accounts for 35% of GDP, which is one of the highest in the world, which is very not good. Why not? Because when you when you have your economy growing with an export industry, basically you're selling products to foreigners abroad. What if the US falls into a recession? Well, the Americans would maybe have less jobs, less income. If they have no jobs or no income, then obviously they're not going to demand the Chinese products. So if that occurs and China is so dependent on the export industry alone, then it's likely that China faces some problem at least. And on top of that, 40% of their exports goes to the US, which is very huge amount. They should not be so dependent on the US. Granted, the China has integrated economically with European countries and a lot of Middle Eastern countries in the recent years, but I think it's easy still to say that China is overly dependent on the export industry alone, and that being the United States. The next question is, but what's the problem with China's export industry growing? I mean, it's an undeveloped economy, a lot of people starving, still 10% unemployment rate, so, you know, it's doing its best. What's wrong with it? I personally have nothing against the peg exchange rate. I think peg exchange rate is actually necessary for undeveloped economies. Peg exchange rate is when a current government basically controls the exchange rate. They peg it, they fix it. In a world full of with developed economies like Japan and the US, they usually let it float. They let the markets do the work. China does not. China has its peg. The problem with the peg in case of China is that China has accumulated excessive reserves. Reserves come from the current account surplus and the capital account surplus. They have extra money in their pocket, basically, and they stash it behind, which obviously automatically causes the deficits on the other side of the world, like the US. You look at this gross international reserves. This is starting 1994, 1995, and on to 2005. What you see obviously is that it didn't grow at all in this period. In 2000, 2001, 2002, something happened. And all of a sudden, the reserves that the China holds exploded, and this whole global imbalance really showed up, and people started to pay more attention, economies first. What happened in 2001? The US fell into recession, dot-com bust, September 11th attack, so the US dollar fell. When the US dollar falls and it is having a recession, it has its own business. What about China? China has its currency RMB pegged to the US dollar. So if the US dollar falls because of its recession, RMB also falls. It's not like China's having a recession, but China's RMB falls anyhow. China's RMB, which has fallen, has regained a great export advantage against other countries, and their trade surplus exploded. Their trade surplus exploded, which led to the current account surplus. And this is exactly what occurred. What makes up China's reserves other than this trade surplus that you just mentioned? It is a hot money. Hot money is a speculative money that hedge funds and speculators across the world basically send over to countries whose currencies they believe are undervalued. The graph shows it a little bit, it's easier to understand. When you look at a capital account of China, this is foreign direct investment, pretty consistent. This is non-foreign direct investment, which includes hot money, mostly. What happened here, it went down to the negative. In other words, during 1997, 1998, 1999, 2000, the money was getting out of China, not coming into China. Why not? Because the Asian crisis. Asian crisis occurred, and as a consequence, Indonesia, Thailand, Philippines, they devalued their currencies. They divided their currencies in order to obtain the export industry again. When they did this, it put tremendous amount of pressure on China to also devalue its currency. Otherwise, they are losing the export advantage. Because if East Asian countries, including China, basically export similar products, most of them. So if these East Asian countries divide their currencies and gain export advantage, China loses the export advantage. But China, after all, did not devalue in this period. They budged in. So what happened? It put tremendous amount of pressure, as I said, on China to devalue. If you're a global investor and you're willing to put the money, why would you put the money in a currency that you think is going to be devalued? So the hot money was getting out of China. What happened in 2000-2001? Basically, the US dollar, as I explained, fell. And RMB also fell. So RMB is no longer in the fear of being devalued. Actually, it is devalued already. Now that it's devalued, why don't I get some RMB? When it appreciates, I'll cash it in, I'll make a lot of profit. So the hot money went from negative to huge positive. And again, hot money is nothing healthy to a country's economy. You know, it's the money that could go in and out at its will. So if China's economy falls or China appreciates, this hot money could fall in a hurry, and which is not a good thing for China. Then you may ask, but for a country to grow, isn't current account surplus inevitable? Because current account surplus, as I mentioned, consists of the trade surplus. China has trade surplus, so there's a current account surplus. You know, what's wrong with it? But my answer is not really. This is the current account of China and another emerging economy that is impressing us all, India. What happened here in 2002, obviously these two lines diverged. China's current account surplus exploded upward. India's current account surplus went down. The main reason for that, I would argue, especially on the later side, is that the oil price rising and imports of India rising. But you can definitely see the difference made here. And again, I would argue that China's RMB was devalued at this time because the US dollar went down, so they gained export advantage, and then their current account surplus exploded.
So slow down, sir. It's talking way too.
I'm sorry. Okay.
I will just on that.
Yes.
Just on that. I mean, a couple of slides back. You said that the Chinese currency had devalued during the Asian financial crisis.
If I could figure out how to go back. I don't know how to go back, but I will go back. Well, but I could explain that. Chinese RMB...
You know, a lot of facts.
I'm very sorry, yes.
No way we can catch up.
Okay, I'm very sorry, sir. Chinese RMB is pegged to the US dollar. If you believe that 2005, last July, it was revalued, you could still believe me that Chinese RMB was pegged to the US dollar in 2000, 2001. That is a fact. What that means is the US dollar falls against the euro, RMB would also fall against the euro. And I have a graph to show that. So what happened? RMB fell, along with the US dollar.
Okay, I
have a graph later to show that exactly. So great. So the current account, is done. Now the US, I said the RMB depreciated along with the US dollar. Oh, the next slide, perfect. In 2002, and my answer is yes. This seems like one line, but actually it's two lines. It is US dollar and RMB relative to euro. Starting in 2001 July, the US dollar fell from 100% to basically 30%, it fell. And what happened to the RMB? It follows the exact same path. And if you don't believe this, I can show you the sites, I can show you the exchange rates. This is inevitable, undeniable fact, I believe. In this regard, I would like to just say that the RMB is depreciating this year again because the US dollar is depreciating, as I've shown. So again, the global imbalance may continue to enlarge if this continues. I'll try to slow myself down. I apologize if I'm speaking too fast. I'm a little nervous, so okay. And the next question, I think, is similar to the question that you asked her. But the peg was dropped last July, no, you may ask. Last July 2005, China's Communist Party and People's Bank of China, they announced that the peg is over. We're dropping the peg. We're making a basket of currencies. What does this basket mean? In a nutshell, if there is an exchange rate between the two currencies, inside the one basket, there was a US dollar. On the other hand, there was RMB. They were pegged before 2005 July. What they're claiming is that now this peg is practically gone. And on top of that, inside this basket that used to have the US dollar, they not only have the US dollar, they have the euro, Japanese yen, Korean won. The trick here is that they don't tell us the weights inside this basket. The US dollar may consist 97% of the weight and 1% each, which basically is the same as a peg of the US dollar alone. Or maybe it's 25% overall. Maybe euro, Japanese yen may have more weights. Practically, we don't know how that is done. In my econometric presentation, I presented that. This is actually not the. All right. Okay. Anyway. I did a multivariable regression, which I will not get into detail, but you could actually try to at least ballpark the weights inside the basket.
this is the US dollar weight, the weight the US dollar holds inside the basket. This is the weight other currencies hold. Again, I'm not going to get into detail of how this is derived. If you like, I'll be happy to show you after this session or whenever. But practically, this tells that the US dollar is still very, holds the majority of the weight, which means that the basket is still not really credible. If anything, the US dollar is still pegged to the RMB. On top of that, the whole idea of the basket is to lose its peg to the US dollar and start to, get other currencies involved. You can see here that US dollar did decline from November to January period to February, March this period. But it went up again, which tells us that this basket is really hard to believe. That's basically the idea of this peg. And again, if you'd like to know how I derived this, I'll be happy to show. And you may wonder, how do you know RMB is undervalued? A lot of economists say RMB is undervalued. And this question is another question this gentleman asked. I think one of the many reasons is due to the productivity improvement. You know, usually when an economy grows so fast for so many years, its economic growth is really expected. So a lot of countries, a lot of investors try to get this currency, and this currency appreciates. That's the idea if the capital account is liberalized in China, and it floats. But it's not, so it's pegged. This graph shows the productivity of Chinese workers starting in 1986 and in 2004. I'm just going to try to emphasize that it went up. And I think everybody can agree here that manufacturing productivity in China's skills and their technology that they are able to use has obviously gone up. So their productivity went up. In a simple sense, that is like saying a Chinese worker used to make one product an hour. Today, they make 100 products an hour. I think they deserve wage. And if they don't deserve a wage, certainly they deserve appreciated currency. Because if the RMB is undervalued, their wage is also undervalued to a certain extent. So I think for the sake of Chinese people working in China, I think appreciation of RMB is justifiable. Okay. This graph, I will emphasize much more, elaborate more. This graph pretty much shows the idea of currency exchange rate manipulation by China. This is the claim that a lot of economists who say that the Chinese manipulates its currency exchange rate would really point out and say, see, that's what's going on. The idea is that the U.S. has trade deficit with China, for example, last year, $200 billion. What does China do with this? China goes to the U.S. Treasury market. Again, when foreigners buy the U.S. Treasury, they usually convert into the U.S. dollars. That's the demand for the U.S. dollar. Demand for the U.S. dollar leads to appreciation of U.S. dollar. And with the U.S. dollar staying strong, Americans are able to buy more imports. If the U.S. dollar is weak, the Americans certainly cannot import from China as much. So the idea that these economists claim is that China is buying the U.S. Treasury partially in order to appreciate the U.S. dollar so they can continue this recycle. Another thing that would happen is that if a country like the U.S. has current account deficit so big, and it's inflation rising, obviously they would raise the rate to stop the consumption and also to contain inflation, as I just mentioned. What would happen if China continues to buy the U.S. Treasury? Then the Fed really has no need to raise the interest rate so much. Why not? Because, first of all, their consumption is being financed. And when a government is trying to sell the U.S. Treasury, usually it likes to hold inflation low, because inflation is 10%. Even if the yield on the U.S. Treasury is 10%, it cancels out by the maturity date. So if the U.S. has current account deficit so big, and they need to sell the U.S. Treasury to finance it, as the Bush administration likes to, then they need to contain inflation. If they need to contain inflation, they need to raise the Fed rate. But if somebody is buying a lot of U.S. Treasury, thank you very much, I don't really need to raise the rate. If the Fed rate stays low, that allows Americans to continue to consume beyond their means, and that allows this recycle to continue once again. And of course, if they buy a lot of long-term treasuries, which I will show on the next slide, the long-term treasury yield also falls. Americans with money in their pockets, would they buy the treasury with low yield? No, they would not. They would rather spend it. So that's the idea. On the bottom, there's the U.S. mortgage market.
which could be simply, more simply put, the U.S. agency market. It doesn't have to be the mortgage, but one of the main is the mortgage that they claim. China buys a lot of agency securities, such as the mortgage agency securities. And what would happen to the mortgage rate? Mortgage rate would fall. Not only due to this, but due to this, because the target rate for the mortgage rate is a U.S. Treasury 10-year note yield. So again, if the yield falls, mortgage rate would fall. And it has fallen from 20% in 1980, and today down to 6.5%. What would happen if the mortgage rate falls? The Americans would buy houses, as you all know. If the Americans buy houses, understand they get the home equity loan, which is a very cheap money. What do they do with this? They buy more imports, and this recycle remains. And also the wealth effect continues. Wealth effect is like saying you feel rich because you have a house. You have a lot of debts, but you feel rich. So hey, why not consume, basically? That's the idea. And the Americans are definitely into that. Does China really intervene in the agency market? And my answer is yes. This is China's holding of long-term debt securities changed from 2004 to 2005. In the total, they went up 50% from 2004 to 2005. That's a lot already. In terms of treasury, they also went up 46%, which is a lot. But here, agency-backed securities, which went up 271%, which is huge, which is more than any other country in the world. In fact, China today holds more agency-backed securities than any other country in the world. Japan still holds more treasury, yes, but China definitely holds more agency-backed securities, and you can see the increase in that, and the corporate, not really. So to a certain extent, that recycle is actually evident. It exists. And I said the Fed rate fell. Is that true? Yes. The 1% Fed rate in 2003-2004 was the lowest since 1930. And if you look at it in real term, which is basically you subtract inflation rate. Inflation rate in 2003-2004 was about 2%, the Fed rate being 1%. What was the real Fed rate? The real Fed rate was negative. If the Fed, real Fed rate is negative, there's humongous excessive liquidity in the commercial banks in the United States. So once again, why would the Americans save in this kind of scenario? Now, that being said, the main reason the Fed lowered the rate is because they had a recession in 2002-2003. So I'm not arguing that, obviously, China alone is doing this. China cannot do this alone. It's impossible. But to a certain extent, from the previous slides, I think you can see that China definitely contributes, at least, to the maintenance of the low Fed rate and the low mortgage rate. What are China's consequences of its peg and intervention? I would argue that these pegs and intervention is not only bad for the global economy, but it's also bad for China itself, because they're accumulating so much reserves at the moment. They have $900 billion in their stashed in, behind. $600 billion of that approximately being in the form of the US dollar. What would happen if the US dollar falls in its value? Their reserves fall in its value. You may think, you know, well, but US dollar is going to go up again, it's not a big deal. But there's opportunity cost. If there's an investment opportunity and they don't have as much in terms of the value of their reserves, then obviously they cannot make the investment, so they are facing a loss. So as long as they continue this peg and intervention and continue to accumulate the US dollar, there is definitely a consequence in that regard. Its economy is already dependent on the exports, as I explained already, which is nothing healthy for its economy. And one of the main reasons the domestic economy in China, more on the inland side, and also the service sectors in China is not being developed, I would argue is because it is so overly dependent on the export industry. It had economic growth, wonderful, with export industry, but you know, I mean, why do you have to continue so much? I think you can really start to disperse your economic growth to the service sectors and domestic side as well. And also, as I've shown, the hot money is flowing into China. And because the hot money is flowing into China, People's Bank of China's rate today is 2.25%, which is relatively low to the global rates today. If the People's Bank of China, supposedly, let us suppose they raise the rate, then most likely the deposit rates would also rise. Not in the same amount, but most likely that's usually the idea. If the deposit rate in China rises, most likely the hot money will flow in even more, because this hot money the global investors throw into China, they've been depositing these commercial banks at first, at least. So the more hot money would come in. So as long as China maintains this peg and intervention, to the global investors at least, RMB is certainly undervalued. That's why the hot money is coming in. Because the hot money is coming in, People's Bank of China cannot raise its rate. And because they do not raise its rate while everybody else did, as I explained, there's excessive liquidity among the Chinese commercial banks. Banks with a lot of liquidity in their hands, they need to lend these money. Otherwise, they cannot just pay the deposit rate. They have no money money coming in. So they lend and they lend and they lend. And I think the issue of overinvestment in China by the commercial banks has been talked much about this year through many economic issues. This excessive lending leads to at least some of them wasteful investment, such as shopping malls, for example. Just for example, not all of them go wrong, but some of them certainly. And that leads to the non-performing loans, which is an issue that China has had for quite some time. So I would argue that China's pegging intervention is not only bad for the global economy, but I think it's also starting to show signs of consequence on the domestic side in China. So the argument three is exactly that. I think China should ease its peg and intervention for its own benefit. And it did ease its peg a bit by creating basket, but again, I think it's not really enough. I think they should do some more. And I said that China lends a lot. Does China lend a lot? I think graph just simply shows this. This is Thailand, Indonesia, Korea, Malaysia, the countries that fell into the Asian crisis in 1997. One of the many reasons why they fell into the Asian crisis, one of the many, is the overinvestment that they really did, and due to their overlending by the banks, which are all short-term. And you can see that most of them went up. I mean, Thailand went up more than 100% of the GDP, so they were lending more than what they make, in a nutshell. What about China today? China alone, this is 2005. The rest are 1997. But you can easily see that China lends just as much as those countries did when they went to the Asian crisis. So I think, to a certain extent, China certainly faces a little bit of risk in terms of lending too much and overinvesting too much. And I said China invests too much. And this graph shows China's investment as share of GDP. You can see that it actually was going down until 2000. As I mentioned, the hot money was not coming into China. If the hot money is not coming into China, this hot money will be deposited in China's commercial banks. And after a while, they'll be lent by the commercial banks and be part of an investment in China. So if that was going down, then obviously the investment would also go down. But in 2001, it started to, again, regain its slope upward. And it has continued to this day to a very dangerous level, I believe. And other than the RMB devaluation, I believe there's another reason why the investment in China has risen, and that is China's joint entry to WTO in 2001. And the foreign enterprises basically rushed into China. And this is relevant to the story that I shared in the beginning. This is exports and imports of China, 1991 to 2001, WTO entry. And what happened? They both accelerated tremendously. So you can see that, first of all, WTO entry affected China very much. And then on this side, on this graph, this is a graph that shows exports by the ownership. You can see that the yellow is the highest, 1995, 1999. What is yellow? It's state-owned enterprises. So, you know, at least it's Chinese enterprises, so that's not bad. But what happened in 2004? This light blue dominated over state-owned enterprise. What is this light blue? It's foreign-owned. And obviously, this is not that much of a good news for the Chinese people living in China. There are some benefits, transfer of skills and technology and whatnot, but I think, you know, state-owned enterprise and Chinese private sectors can really develop some more. They can get more attention. Since WTO, that doesn't seem to be the case. And how is the social tension in China? There was already an article, plenty of articles, that said that in China there was over 780,000 riots last year, especially on the rural side. This is coming from Mr. Liu Wang in China Ministry of Public Security. I borrowed it straight. But you can see the increase in the number of the riots and social unrest in China. So I think despite its economic growth that is rising, income inequality is also rising, and also the foreigners are taking over a lot of parts of China. So I think it's understandable to a certain extent that there is somewhat of a social unrest in China that is building up. When there is a high inflation, usually people are more in trouble because that means the price is rising and that affects the poor people more than the rich people. Inflation in China is very low. It's close to 1%. So it's somewhat hard to understand why there's so much social unrest in China despite its low inflation. That shows that basically there is definitely something else other than inflation that is affecting these Chinese people's satisfaction with its globalization. And once again, if the global imbalance increases, the U.S. will face inflation. And inflation in the U.S. has been rising. And again, if the inflation in the U.S. rises and the U.S. dollar depreciates, it's automatic the RMB depreciates. And it has depreciated this year already. Then most likely, inflation in China may also rise. Not definite, but it increases its likely probability. So I think this is somewhat of a concern. Why is inflation so low, though, in the last couple of years? And I believe there are several hypotheses, and I think there are several that we can really believe. One is the culture. If a Chinese man makes $10 an hour and next day he makes $100 an hour, I don't think he's going to spend $100 in a moment. If he probably, this is just a guess, he'll probably spend $20 maybe up to his necessity and save $80. What would an American tell the guy? Well, American would tell the guy to spend $100 and use that $100 as collateral and borrow $100 and spend $200 instead. That's the difference of culture. But if culture is what it is, then why is the consumption in China falling today and the saving rate instead of rising? This excessive saving in China is not something we've always seen. It really started to develop after 2000. Low inflation, well, this argument is somewhat hard to understand somewhat because I'm arguing why is inflation low, the consumption is low, and one of them is low inflation. But it's easy to understand if you go from the backward. If the inflation is low, the price level is low. If the price level is low, you don't have to consume as much usually, so you could afford to save. But inflation is high, price level is high, you may have to spend $100 a day, so you cannot really afford to save. So that may be one of the reasons, because inflation has been low, and saving in China rises. It's somewhat understandable. But another thing that I would argue, and I have been arguing throughout this presentation somewhat, is a sense of insecurity, I believe. You can see that after 2000, Chinese consumption really went down and the saving rate went up. As I've shown, the foreigners already started to dominate after 2000, 2001 WTO entry. With the foreigners right next to you indulging themselves, spending 405 RMB in a second, and you cannot even afford to eat 5 RMB noodle, I think it's somewhat understandable you really try to save and try to catch up with the guy next to you. So I think that's another argument that I would make, argument for Chinese have saved feeling insecure being joined by the foreigners a little too explosively, too fast. So what is my solution? On the U.S. side, to fix this global imbalance, which I'll not elaborate too much, I'll elaborate more on the China side. Certainly they should fix their fiscal policy. This year the Bush administration's fiscal deficit is scheduled to increase again. And also, we should invest in something other than our houses. Real estate industry in the United States is great, but no matter how much we invest in houses, real estate industry, we can never export houses. We can never trade houses. So real estate industry growth never helps our trade growth. If our problem is the trade, then certainly we should invest in something else, mathematics, science, and engineering, and all these other wonderful things that China and India are investing in. What about China? I believe they should establish more social safety nets, and this has been going on. Chinese Communist Party has stated recently that they're going to work on this year. But more they do this, there's a benefit. If people feel secure about their lives, maybe with a minimum wage being higher, or unions being more freely allowed, labor regulations being set, environmental regulations, and all these things being really established, I think people feel more secure about their lives, and they don't have to save as much. They could consume some more. And if they consume, obviously the current account surplus will decline, which will help the global economy, as I mentioned, because China's current account surplus is so huge, mainly because they save so much. They save in their reserves and they save in everything else. But if they consume, current account surplus will decline, and that would at least allow the pressure on the U.S. current account deficit to increase to go down somewhat. And also, if they establish more social safety nets and people start to consume domestically, then I think China's economy can be more domestically oriented creating service sectors, which is, again, it's exactly what they need. Service sectors create more jobs than the export sectors, usually the cases. And even in the export sectors, as I've shown, state-owned enterprises dominate most of it. So to create private sectors, I think it would be a great idea for China to domestically orient its economy and on the service sectors. And also, I think they should appreciate the RMB by 10%. A lot of economists would say, but, you know, Japanese yen was pegged to the US dollar in the 1970s, 380 yen to Japanese yen. And after the Plaza Accord in 1985, Japanese yen appreciated. So did the trade surplus of Japan go down against the US? Actually, it went up. So a lot of people would say that, you know, this appreciation may not work in the case of China. But I think there's a little bit of distinct difference between the case of Japan and China. Japan at the time already had established their global brands, a lot of high-tech companies that were basically, to a certain extent, necessity from the perspective of the U.S. As I've already shown, most of the export industry is dominated by the foreign-owned enterprises. So if the RMB appreciates, I do believe that some of the foreign-owned enterprises will flee to some other countries. They may not, they may still see the labor arbitrage, cheap labor being the profit, and they may stay in China. But I think some of them will go out, and I think the trade deficit the U.S. holds against China may start to fall a little bit. Of course, if they appreciate the RMB, even by 10%, international pressure will ease. G7 and IMF and every other international community has made a statement that obviously China's RMB should appreciate, so I think it will excuse them from too much pressure to appreciate their currency. And again, if they appreciate the RMB, then no longer RMB is undervalued that much, so the hot money will start to decline, which I think is exactly what China would like to see. They don't like to see hot money come in so much from speculators and hedge funds and whatnot. If the RMB appreciates also, strong RMB would allow Chinese domestic population to import more. And again, that would allow the Chinese trade surplus to not accelerate so fast. There's nothing wrong with export industry growing again, but I believe it is really advancing and growing a little bit too fast, not really by China itself, but a lot by the foreign-owned enterprises and the hot money, which is, again, not something that China can really trust on. And also, of course, if they allow the RMB to appreciate and they're not as domestically, as export overly, if they're not as overly dependent on the export, I don't think they have to intervene in the markets as much as they today do. And again, that would allow this claim of is China manipulating the currency exchange rate to frankly go away to a certain extent. And that is the good news for China. And they would not hold so much reserves. Because they intervene in the mortgage market, agency market, and the long-term treasury market, they hold so much reserves. Again, in terms of reserves, most of it is in the form of the US dollar. So if the US dollar goes down, their reserves go down. So overly being dependent on the reserves is really bad for China in the long run. If they stop intervening, because if they appreciate the RMB, then most likely, I believe they will not have to intervene and the reserve will not increase as much as it is today. And this argument is somewhat crucial. The other East Asian countries would follow the same path. Last year, China revalued its currency somewhat, July 2005. And what happened? Malaysia also dropped its peg 2 hours later. And other East Asian countries also allowed their currencies to appreciate. Why did that happen? The other East Asian countries are arguably competing with China to get the export advantage. So if China appreciates, other East Asian countries would also allow their currencies to appreciate. And in that regard, Malaysian ringgit appreciated this year already by 7% or so. Chinese RMB has not. Since last July, it appreciated by 1% or 2%, which is peanuts. So I think if the East Asian countries would also appreciate their currencies, and also in this regard, I think the oil exporting countries like Saudi Arabia, who has rial its currency pegged to the US dollar, should also appreciate their currency. And if they do that, finally, I think the global imbalance would diminish, and I think this problem would go away. When is the deadline? Before I show this 2008 interesting story, is that a lot of economists, this may be fictional, Chinese Communist Party, one of the politicians was listening to two economists talk about, yes, we should allow RMB to appreciate, yes, and the other saying, no, we should let it remain pegged. And the governor, in the end, said, okay, I've heard both of your stories. I think appreciating RMB is good in the long run, and I think being pegged is good in the short run. And so the economist asked, well, when is this short run? When is this long run? And the governor said, well, you know, China is a country with history of 4,000 years, so short term maybe another 100 years, who knows? I don't think that really cuts the international tension being built today. And I think 2008 is certainly one of the, not perhaps early, and not really significant, but certainly a deadline. Why? Beijing Olympics is coming up in 2008. By then, they should really develop their service sectors and really ease the international pressure that is building up. If the U.S. current account deficit increases this year, global imbalance issue will catch more tension, and China will be less favored, and I don't think that's a good news, good advertisement for China in terms of Olympic coming up, and Shanghai World Expo in 2010 as well. 2008 is the first year that baby boomers in the U.S. retire, so the U.S. deficit become more clear to us all. So I think, again, another reason why the U.S. fiscal deficit, U.S. current account deficit, this whole global imbalance issue will catch more attention. And I think that'll be it. So, and now we can move to the Q&A session. I apologize for going too fast. I'm a little nervous. So.
I think we had a fast economy lesson. And one thing I learned is don't buy any houses in the U.S.
That's not good for us, yes.
No, that's not what my dad told me. You know, buy a house and settle down.
Ah, okay.
He told me. I thank him, and I would like to say
thank you. From the floor.
Yes, question.
I was just going to say hello to you first, Betty, and nice to see her again. And if there are any questions, I'm sure there are burning questions from the audience. I would let him take the questions and answer them.
I don't know where you learned the from college. But I'm sure you learn anything from macroeconomics. Your talk except is 99% focused on the current deficit. Not on the fiscal deficit. It's a twin deficit. Right. You never mentioned the role the U.S. play in a whole situation. U.S. currency is a reserve currency of the world. It's a dominant currency. You did not talk about that role. You cannot talk about the role of debasing of the U.S. currency deliberately by the United States government. You cannot talk about how U.S. blow its budget by carrying the war in Iraq, in Vietnam, fiscal irresponsibility at home, just write checks to get votes, and deal with social problems, post-war social problems, from social security and on for housing market. Okay, those are basis of those are part of the fiscal deficit that lead to the debasement of U.S. dollar. The U.S. dollar doesn't do worth shit anymore. It's going down. You talk about it, but you focus on the appearance of trade deficit in China, the current account deficit. Even there, you did not go into in-depth dynamics of it. I mean, just mention that I came to this lecture because I got an internet mail about the lost generation in Japan, which you make reference to the 80s, that which you also mentioned the Plaza Agreement. The U.S. on the wave of a pan, okay, forced Japan to make its currency appreciate several times. You said that trade deficit has gone up. Yes, over a period of time. But what caused the lost generation, the deflation in Japan for over 10 years? That was caused directly by the Plaza Agreement, which is the debasing of the U.S. currencies, and let the Japanese take the brunt of the wasteful expenditure by the United States. Okay. We, Asian American United States, suffered tremendously because of anti-Asian stereotypes. There was a man called Vincent Chin that was beaten to death as an auto worker, his engineer, because he was mistaken as a Japanese in Japan, because they were bashing Japan for causing a problem at home. You are now using the same methodology in China. I mean, your talk could be better than any vulgar politician, populist politician, could ever do. All right? I mean, just get even on the current account deficit issue. All right, even on the current account deficit issue, you mentioned that sounds like China's, you know, sucking up the money for the rest of the world, and the U.S. economy is declining. But what about Japan? What about Southeast Asia? What about Malaysia? What about Singapore? What about Taiwan? What about entire Philippines? The entire, and what about Europe and Latin America?
Okay.
Their economy has gone up in the last 10 years because of trade with China. Okay? And you just gloss over the fact that the U.S. has a tremendous trade deficit with China, but then you also mentioned, well, trade deficit with them, China export are like, sometimes are done by foreign owned companies. 70% of China export are exported by foreign owned companies in China. And the money, the value added, directly feeds right into the rest of Asia, into Europe and Latin America.
I think there's more questions, so I'll take a couple questions at a time.
I'll stop.
We can talk later. Yes.
Well,
okay.
I mean, Kazuo, I thank you for your presentation. I've certainly learned a lot, and I certainly understand, like, you were doing an overview of your presentation as to what's currently happening, and the question I had was, what if, like, everybody who's holding treasuries do pray to them or say they want to get their money back, or when it comes due, what could the U.S. be faced with then? Could it be a depressed economy then, or what will happen if all these foreign investors who are holding our treasury bills do cash it in?
I'll take a few more questions at the same time, I think.
Why don't you answer them one by one?
Okay. Well, first of all, I should have mentioned that, you know, this title is Global Imbalance in China. If it's just the global imbalance, I would mention much more on the U.S. side, because I actually do completely agree with you that the U.S. has, if not more, just as much role to play in terms of fixing the global imbalance. I believe a lot of things the Bush administration did is wrong, and I think the Fed certainly maintained the rate that is a little bit too low for too long of a time that allowed the Americans to consume beyond their means. And now they can't get out of that habit. I do agree with that. So generally speaking, actually, I agree with most of the things you're saying. It's just that I did not present those parts because this is more global imbalance and how China plays its role, as I mentioned in the beginning, and also how is China manipulating the currency exchange. That's the issue that I was really trying to get into. Another thing about you compare Japan and Japanese deflation. And I think economists like Mr. Robert McKinnon of Stanford University agrees with exactly what you're saying. If China allows RMB to appreciate, it may cause deflation in China, just like it did in Japan, a lot of people would argue. I'm not trying to argue this another argument, but I'd like to point out that in Japan what happened is that when they allowed the Japanese yen to appreciate, in order to offset the appreciation, they had a very loose monetary policy. They lowered their rate tremendously. And you can check this on a historic record. What happened with that is exactly what is happening to China today. A low rate, there was overlending and overinvestment, which led to the creation of the bubble, which burst. I'm not saying that the appreciation of Japanese yen had nothing to do with the deflation, but I certainly think the same thing is happening. That's exactly what is happening in China. Because China, in order to disguise its undervalued currency, is keeping their PBOC rate very, very low to justify, actually. Justify their undervalued currency, which again, as I've shown with the graph, is domestically creating consequences for the Chinese people. And I think their lending is, as I've shown, is as high as those countries in the East Asian crisis, which is very dangerous for China. They are mostly short-term because they are borrowed from the banks. So I think that's basically the argument that I'd like to point out. If China appreciates currency, I think it would be better because People's Bank of China rate can rise because hot money will not come. As much as it is today, and stop this lending bubble and overinvestment bubble, which is one of the reasons, at least, that led to the deflation in Japan. And this lady asked, what if the foreign central banks and other foreigners ask for the money back? Then obviously what would happen is that the US dollar would collapse in a moment. And actually, that is a very interesting argument because a lot of people would say, well, that's never going to happen. Because if the foreigners do that, the US dollar would depreciate, collapse, and the US economy would collapse. And if the US economy collapsed, global economy would also likely collapse, and that would be very damaging for the rest of the world. In terms of that, again, Barry Eichengreen of University of California, Berkeley said that in collectively, these foreign central banks have the interest to buy the U.S. Treasury, appreciate the U.S. dollar, depreciate their currencies relatively, and obtain their export advantage. But individually, what if a country A all of a sudden said, that's it, no more U.S. Treasury, I'm out. Then the U.S. dollar would fall a little bit. And what if the country next to it also follows the same path? Hey, I think the U.S. dollar is going to go down some more. I should get out of this fast. And the country B follows the same path. And what if country C does the same? And this could go on forever, cause a stampede, which is something that we've seen before. And it's exactly the creation of a bubble, in many sense, oil and, or real estate or anything. So that's the consequence that we could see. And that's why I think before global imbalance gets too big to handle, I think we should really try to minimize it or prevent it from popping. Any other questions or comments? Yes.
Let's talk about some practical matters. The Chinese RMB has appreciated by 2.5% last July, as you mentioned.
Mm-hmm.
And I think in the last few months, Chinese yuan has an appreciation of like less than 1%. And some economists, they say that by the end of this year, Chinese RMB will go up to maybe 7.8 yen per dollar, or maybe by next year it'll go up to 6.5. So in the next 1 or 2 years, in the short term, is there any strategy like we as investors in the U.S. can make in order to make some profits? You know, in the picture, in the big broad picture of Chinese RMB appreciation. Chinese RMB is not convertible right now, but is there any other strategy we can use to make some profits, personal profits?
I might take some more questions at the same time. I would prefer to do that. I think there was another one. Yes.
And you said that Chinese economy is dependent on exports, which is obvious, but you said that they should spread out, like into the service economy or into the service sector. And I was wondering, I mean, what's wrong with being dependent on exports? That's cheap. I mean, the labor is cheap. They can, like, almost everything I have, being the pen to the cup, the part of my shirt is made in China. They specialize in it. They can make the product cheaply, and they can export it. Just like the U.S. is dependent, like you said, on the service sector. Like, you know, businesses, etc. Service sector businesses excel in the U.S., hence they should specialize in that. Like, why would you? I mean, like, if China right now tried to specialize or tried to expand in the service sector, the competition that it faces from people that are established in that would make it very likely that they would fail. So, I mean, one, what's wrong with them being dependent on the export and something that they do well? And two, like, how could they compete with somebody that's already established in a, let's say, a service sector business?
Okay, I'll answer the second question first. Naturally, usually, economy that is undeveloped, it is preferred. A lot of economists can disagree with this, I think. But if you're an undeveloped economy, most likely your wage level is very low. So why not? Yes, exactly. Why don't you just grow your export industry and get some economic growth going on and get some capital inflow, get some technology and skills learned from the foreigners? I think to that extent, I think that's absolutely correct. But in the long run, being overly dependent on the export industry, again, is very dangerous, because if your customer country falls into recession, most likely your export industry automatically goes down. You see this in Caribbean islands, which are very overly dependent on tourism. In the 70s, the U.S. fell into recession here and there, and their customers never came. So automatically, Caribbean islands fell into a real big trouble. So, in the long run, it is very desirable that China develops domestic economy. And if you look at the developed economies, most of them are that. The U.S. or the European countries, most of them are that. And you talked about the labor, cheap labor being their specialty. That is certainly true at this moment. But if they want to develop in the long run, certainly they don't want to maintain that kind of advantage. They like their per capita income, to rise from $3,000 as it is today to $40,000, where the U.S. is. That's when the people can finally really prosper nationwide. So I think in the long run, it's very smart to for China to turn to more domestically oriented economy. The question is when, and I think China should start to at least get into that path. And you look in the last 3 years, China's export industry actually did not shrink, but it actually accelerated once again due to the U.S. dollar depreciation, RMB depreciation. So it's not doing the China's good. I don't see China crisis at all in the next 2 or 3 years. China has practically no external debts, so it's not very dangerous, but domestically I think the real estate bubble is a concern. Andy Xie of Morgan Stanley talked about this to many extent, and I could give you some citation in that. In terms of how to make money off this, it's a question that I think a lot of hedge fund managers have been wondering for the last 5 years. If you buy the RMB today, that RMB one US dollar, to make a very simple analogy, you put in $100 million, you get 800 million RMB. And let's suppose the RMB appreciated next year to one RMB to one US dollar. So what happened? You just cash it in, you make $800 million. You just made a profit of 700%, so that's wonderful. That sounds like a very nice idea. And actually that's why undervalued currencies, which is usually pegged, because if you're an investor, you look at a pegged currency, it's obvious if it's undervalued or overvalued. If the currency is floating, it's really hard to guess. So in terms of that, I can't really give you the answer that's satisfying. If you think it's going to be appreciated, you might as well. But looking at the Chinese Communist Party's talk that they've given in the recent weeks, I don't think they have any plan of appreciating RMB too much in the near future.
That is their strategy. They don't want to allow the foreign investor to have an advantage in benefiting from any upside or downside. So far, they've been successful. There's no reason why they should allow a foreigner to devastate their economy.
Well, you absolutely...
They're hollowing out the U.S. economy, okay, whether the U.S. likes it or not. It's not with the U.S. permission.
No. Well, if the you're absolutely right that China's intention is not to allow these hedge funds who is betting on RMB appreciation to.
It's not like they are failing to see that we're not diversified. I think they're graduating at the right time. They're maximizing the export advantage right now. Why did they really have the advantage?
As long as the I don't see that as a question, as a comment instead, so I will not answer. Yes.
I just want to make a comment that a lot of you also mentioned that. A lot of the enterprises are foreign-owned, and you saw what a big section that is, remember, on your graph?
Yes.
Actually, these companies are going in. Almost all these big companies in the United States are going in, and they are investing in China. They are the ones who are manufacturing. They're the base. They are profiting from the cheap labor and the conditions in China. To manufacture goods so that they can bring them to this country and sell it cheap so that we can all benefit. And then who benefits from the money? Actually, we talk a lot about the trade deficit and that the United States owes so much money to China in the trade deficit. But actually, the share owners of all the stock who are investors in China are also profiting a lot, and a lot of that is not brought out.
Although that's a comment, I like to. Oh, yes. Okay.
If you want me to phrase it as a question, it's a question. In terms of a current account deficit, what percent the current account deficit for many components? Trade is one of them, but also direct investment. The profit that's retained by corporation, what percentage of that is the direct investment from foreign countries that has not returned to for the U.S. to invest in China, okay, and that has not pulled back the investment, nor have they repatriated the profit? What percentage of that in the trade current account deficit is that?
Okay. First of all, just to comment on your question, your argument is very widespread. A lot of people make the same arguments. The U.S. also invests in China, and they make a lot of profits. So the U.S. is playing a role in it. The U.S. actually invests only 10% of the overall foreign direct investment that goes into China. It's actually East Asian countries, and I have the IMF statistics.
So
again, yes. Well, if you like, I can definitely give you the sources. I'll be happy to. Morris Goldstein, actually, of the Institute of International Economics, has argued in this regard. Another thing about this argument that China's imports, that is very cheap, is very benefiting the Americans. Let us suppose there is a world without the United, without China, or the, well, you know, easier to understand. Let us go back to time before the 1990s, before the Soviet Union collapsed and globalization started very rapidly. At the time back then, the U.S. Wage level was very high. And this is another thing I can definitely give you the citation. The U.S. real wage level has not risen ever since, or even time before that. Why not? Because the offshoring have already started back then. So let us suppose that globalization since 1990 never occurred. The wage in the U.S. would be higher than what it is today. And the Americans will be able to afford the products that are more expensive anyhow. So speaking, just to say that Chinese imports are cheap, so the Americans are benefiting, does not really stand. Moreover, the IMF again has really recently published this article that showed that despite the fact that imports from these developing economies, including China and India, are very cheap, the relative price level change in the U.S. due to that is actually very limited. It's not really high. Inflation in the U.S. has been relatively small in the last few years, mainly because the U.S. was in the recession. That is argument made by them. And I'm not saying that it's definitive. Your argument is sound and it's widespread, so there's nothing wrong with that. Your question.
Well, basically,
talk later.
Like General Motors, for example, most profitable in China. They're losing money here, and I think about 2 years ago, they made more profit in China than anywhere else. And the profit will not return to the United States. To China. That become part of the in fact, U.S. Congress last year to encourage corporations to retrieve some of the money, the profit they made in China, and they succeeded to get back something like less than a special tax holiday, 5% or something like that. Okay, that means what percentage of that the record in terms of is that is not besides the trade.
Your question is actually very interesting, and it's interesting idea, which actually the U.S. actually did impose last year, Homeland Investment Act. They lowered the tax rate of the U.S. companies abroad from 35% to 15% or so, and due to that, there was $350 billion capital inflow from abroad. And if you like the percentage, that is $350 billion divided by 810, so if you can do the math, that is about 40% or so. Yes, so what you're arguing for that to happen, I think it happened.
No, most of the money I'm not.
No, 300, okay.
Small fraction of it.
Okay. Any other, yes.
So what I'm saying is that I have a calculation of what is the U.S., what is the U.S. profit in China that has not been repatriated?
Question, please.
American asked that consumer country in the world.
Yes.
So how do you see this relation between
I actually agree with that, yes. Any other question? Well, first you asked, you talked about the cheap labor in China leading to the cheap price of Chinese products, leading to the benefits of the United States. I think that question is actually exactly the same with her. That argument is sound in a short run, and on top of that, if and you also talked about investment from the U.S. Again, investment by the Americans into China is still limited. It's not that much. Instead, they consume, they demand these products, which is exactly what is creating the global, economic growth in China that is very marvelous to see. So I think the U.S. does contribute to the economic growth in China, certainly. They have $200 billion trade deficit alone. That means the U.S. is giving $200 billion in a nutshell to China. China's GDP is $2 trillion, 2.5, which nobody's really sure exactly, but that is about 10% of its entire GDP. So it's a great contribution. And on the other side, about the U.S. side, again, just like the gentleman over there, I agree with everybody in here that the U.S. has more role to play, and the Bush administration is not doing anything to help this global imbalance diminish. Not at all. I do agree with that. In 20 years from today, what would happen?
The U.S. will become country.
I do believe that. I do believe that the peg of RMB and the U.S. dollar would definitely diminish, unless some unlikely event occurs. International pressure is way too high. The IMF and G7 has never just pointed a finger at one country alone, but they recently did to China. So there is definitely a pressure rising, and for China to integrate to the global economy, they cannot just refuse every demand or request by the rest of the world. In terms of choosing the exchange rate, the IMF allows every country to choose its own exchange rate. It says so, yes, but mutually agreed upon, at least to a certain extent. And also it allows countries to intervene in these markets, and it's fine, but not excessive amount. The question is, what is excessive and when is it neutral? And these are never definitive, so it's a question. But as international pressure rises, I think China will have to appreciate its currency. China will, I believe, be more domestically oriented. Otherwise, I think I really see this export industry bubble rising to a very dangerous level as it is already. The U.S. global economy has, as I said, in the last few years had a great economic growth, 3 years in a row. But this kind of cycle is always comes to an end. There's a downward. And when that happens, if China is overly dependent on the export industry alone, China's economy will definitely start to fall as well. Whereas economies that are more domestically oriented, like the European countries all integrated together, they may survive at least somewhat, although their economic growth is poor already. yes, any other?
No, I have another question.
He hasn't gone, so I think we should, yes. You have a question? Okay,
yeah. All right.
Ah, her. Sorry. Somebody who hasn't gone.
I will be right. Yes. First, I want to pop in and then we'll see our next head. So, I have a question. You have a very interesting topic. And one question is, like, do you really believe like Chinese RMB is undervalued? And the second question is, if you are Chinese government, what should you do, like, the world, like, and what's the government to appreciate its currency? What is strategy and from your research and your perspective?
I think for China's own benefit, as I've explained in the last paragraph, last slide, China should provide more social safety nets for its own people, because that will allow people to feel more secure about their lives. And if they do, they will consume more, and consumption domestically will lead to less trade surplus against other countries like the U.S., less pressure from the international community, and also domestically economy will start to grow, which is exactly what China would like to do. So social safety net is first thing, number one, which they're starting to already, but I think they should do some more. Education on the rural side, even to a high advanced level, being free, I think is somewhat understandable. And if they have so much reserves, I mean, I don't understand why you cannot spend these reserves for these good investment, obviously. Appreciation of RMB, I think, is necessary. If there's 100 arguments out there, I think 98 of them would say RMB is undervalued, and two of them would say RMB is not. So, despite the fact